Hi, welcome to our Pharma Topics channel. Our topic of discussion is lead discovery or identification. The leads are the compounds for which the chemical structure is available and they exhibit the promising pharmacological activity on the selected targets. Various approaches for lead discovery are discoveries are based on traditional screening. Some are based on random screening, and there are non-random screening methods for lead identification. And sometimes many drugs are identified through serendipitous drug discovery patterns also. And it is also discovered on the basis of drug metabolism studies. And lead discovery is also based on the clinical findings also. So let us see these methods in detail. So some of the discoveries which are serendipitous. Serendipity means accidental drug discovery. So Perkin's dye was identified in the 18th century by Perkins. He tried to synthesize quinine, but he discovered a dye which is called aniline purple, tyrian blue, and many dyes which are used in pharmacological uses are dyes. And the first dye concept was established by Perkins in the year 18th century. The next is Alexander Fleming, the classical example. He was doing research on influenza in the Staphylococcus culture plate. Suddenly it was contaminated with the mold Penicillium notatum. He found the zone of inhibition, and from that many lead compounds have been identified, and they are developed into drugs such as benzyl penicillin, ampicillin, or amoxicillin. The next is Leo Stenbach of Roche Pharmaceuticals. He was trying to discover the tranquilizers. He was working on the set of compounds quinazoline 3 oxide. And after his discovery, no compounds were successful. Some vials were left behind. And when finally the vials were tested, he got some lead compounds which led to the discovery of Librium. Then further led to the discovery of diazepam and oxazepam, which are used in nowadays also. So the tranquilizers which are invented dates back to the discovery of Roche Pharmaceuticals. And the next is some of the cattle which ate the sweet clover hay, which are spoiled with the fungus. They found they have the problem of bleeding. So, Carl Paul Link, University of Wisconsin, discovered the fungus contains some lead compounds such as coumarin and doukoumeral, which led to these bleeding disorders. So, the Wisconsin Animal Research Foundation, WARF, launched the rat poison in the year after a few years after the discovery of coumarin and doukoumeral, and the warfarin, the famous warfarin, is now used as an anticoagulant. And the next is Rosenberg was the scientist who worked on the influence of electric field on the growth of E. coli. And the electrodes used were different electrodes. One among them was platinum electrodes. So he found that platinum electrodes, when it is used, the growth of the E. coli got reduced. So from that, the concept reached cisplatin came into the platinum compounds emerged as lead compounds, which led to the discovery of the anti-cancer compound cisplatin. There is a monster called Heloderma suspectum called Gila monster. When it bites its prey, it falls down by reduction in the sugar levels, and this led to the discovery of incretin mimetics, GLP-1 analogs, which is exenatide given as subcutaneous injection for type 2 diabetic patients. And the Bothrop's Geranka, it was a rat, the viper snake. It led to the discovery of the antihypertensive captopril. And John Cade was a psychiatrist. He was instrumental in discovery of lithium. Lithium was previously used to treat gout and bladder stones. In guinea pigs, when they are injected with the urine of the patients, normal, and the patients who were on lithium, he found that the guinea pigs were calm when they were having lithium. So now it is used as an antimaniac drug. The lead discoveries from the other traditional medicines, which are many, we have the traditional system of medicines, Ayurveda, Siddha, Yunani, and other systems, Chinese medications. So many compounds, natural compounds emerged as lead compounds. The most famous is natural morphine, codeine, then quinine. It was obtained from the Peruvian bark. Then Chinese plant Xinghao. It led to the discovery of artemisinin compounds. And then paclitaxel, the anti-cancer compound, atropine and D-tubecurarine. Then for example, kaolin was a lead molecule from the plants. It led to the discovery of sodium chromoglycate, used as in the respiratory medicine, and amiodarone, which is used as a cardiac arrhythmic drug. And the lead molecule from the grass, galangin, Galanga officinalis, led to the discovery of biguanides such as metformin. And then papaverin was a famous antispasmodic, and that was a lead compound for the discovery of verapamil, which is a calcium channel blocker. Lead discoveries from random screening are the new chemical entities obtained from natural sources or from the synthetic libraries are screened for multiple targets to find the possible pharmacological activities of the compounds to find the suitable ligand. So it is time consuming, expensive. With the advent of high throughput screening, thousands of compounds can be screened for multiple targets in a short span of time. So antibiotics like streptomycin and tetracycline were discovered by this method. Another method is a non-random screening. It is a modified form of random screening. It is a focused approach. The time consumption is less when compared to the random screening. It's a narrow approach. So compounds with similar structures are taken for the study to bind with the selected target. This increases the chances of success of the ligand in a chosen bioassay. The new compounds will have limited structural dissimilarity. And then the lead discovery based on drug metabolism studies are, for example, prontosin was the earlier lead molecule. When it got metabolized, it gave rise to sulfanilamide or sulfa compounds, which are used as antibacterials. And astenylide, the metabolite is paracetamol, which is very widely used as a COX-3 inhibitor to relieve the fever. And then the metabolite of hydroxyzine, which is the first generation antihistamine. Its metabolite is cetirizine, which lacks the CNS adverse effects, is a classical second generation antihistamine. Then some leads are identified based on the clinical observations. So the famous one is sildenafil. Actually, it was developed by Pfizer as an anti-anginal drug. The adverse effect was penile erection. Now this adverse effect is the main use. Now it is used for treatment of erectile dysfunction and pulmonary hypertension. The next is clonidine was originally developed as a nasal decongestant. The adverse effect was sedation. Now it is used for treatment of systemic hypertension. It is used as a sedative medication also, tranquilizer also. The rational approaches for lead discovery are rational. It finds a particular target. It's a new inventive method for finding the new medications. It involves three steps. It is a systematic review. Step one is identification of a target such as enzyme or receptor which is related to a particular disease state. Step two is characterization of the identified target structurally and functionally. Step three is a design molecule such that they interact on the selected target. So the rational approaches to lead discovery, we'll see some examples. H2 blockers used in treatment of peptic ulcer. So here the biological target was H2 receptors, where histamine binds to it. This was taken as the lead molecule. Histamine was taken as the lead molecule, and structural modifications were done in the lead molecule. So that led to the discovery of N-guanosyl guanyl histamine, which exhibited antagonistic property. Further, it was modified, optimization was done, and cimetidine came to the market. Nowadays, ranitidine, nizatidine, olapatidine, several H2 blockers are available. So this was a rational approach. The next is selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. Serotonin, the lead molecule is this. From this, structural modification was done, and fluoxetine and paroxetine came into the market by optimization of the structural modification. So optimization of the lead structure. So this involves identification of the pharmacophore, functional group optimization, structural activity relationship studies, homologation, cyclization of the side chain, and reversal of the functional groups, and use of bioisosteer concepts. So let us see the optimization of the lead structure by identification of the pharmacophore. So it is nothing but the molecular features of the compound responsible for interaction with the biological target. So in this, let us see the pharmacophoric features of the morphine analogs essential to bind with the mu receptor. So this is taken as a template, and for that the leads are designed, they are optimized such that they will exhibit a similar interaction with the receptors, which are the amino acids which are at the vicinity of the receptors are taken for consideration. So pharmacophore of the narcotics appears like this. From this, it is taken as a lead molecule. From this, several compounds were synthesized. One among them is methadone, which is used for maintenance therapy of morphine addiction. The next approach is functional group optimization. So the pharmacophore of thiazide diuretics looks like this. It's sulfonamide. And from these, the lead compounds modifications were done. Antihypertensive with diuretic activity, that is chlorothiazide. Further modifications were done. Diazoxide was discovered. It was the antihypertensive without diuretic activity. The next is structural activity relationship. So it is the structural activity, let us see the structural activity relationship of sulfonamide drugs. So the different sulfonamides are given in this case. So the structural activity relationship tells whether it is antibacterial or whether it is anti-diabetic or whether it is a diuretic based on the relationships it has in its structure. The next is homologation, optimization of the lead structure using homologation. So it is a constant unit difference in the series of compounds is called homologation. So N-hexyl resorcinol is used as a topical anesthetic in throat lozenges, whereas N-octyl resorcinol was used as a hypnotic because it exhibits hypnotic activity. The next is cyclization, a method used for optimization of the lead structure. So lignocaine, when cyclization of the side chains were done, it gave rise to a more potent local anesthetic called bupivacaine. So it is one of the example for optimization of the lead structure using cyclization. The next is inversion of the functional groups for optimization of the lead structures. So indomethacin, when the inversion of functional groups were done, it gave rise to the more potent clomethacin, which is used as a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory group. So next is optimization of the lead structures using bioisosterism. The groups can be interchanged to increase the pharmacokinetic activity. So the monovalent atoms which could be interchanged are given here, and the divalent atoms which could be interchanged, trivalent atoms which could be interchanged, and the tetravalent atoms which could be interchanged without compromising the pharmacological activity. And ring equivalents are given, suppose for benzene, thiazole or pyrimidine or pyridine or furand rings. So let us see the drug discovery process through computer aided drug designing. The disease targets will be identified and it will be validated. It may be a genetic approach or a proteomic approach by identification of the proteins which are responsible for the disease. The leads will be identified for these targets and they will be optimized. And then molecular docking studies or high throughput screening methods will be taken for the selected leads, and identification of the best leads will be, the inference will be taken from the molecular docking studies, and they will enter the preclinical studies in different animal models, or the gene manipulation methods are also available nowadays. And then clinical studies will be performed, and after that it will be going for FDA approval and the drug will be launched in the market. It's a small schematic approach of the computer-aided drug design. So I hope the different methods for lead identification is given in this video. It will be useful for you. Thank you for listening. Happy learning. Kindly share this to more of your friends. Kindly subscribe to our Pharma Topics channel for further updates. Thank you.